1-1 pitch. A swing and a drive to deep right. Away back. Goal!
Lindor goes down. Drives it high and deep. And his 100th career home run makes it to the second deck in right field. Ground ball up the gut. Lindor trying to cut it off. He does. Gets rid of it in a hurry. One bounce throw on the money to retire birdie for out number two.
Nicely done.
Blasted to short. What a play by Lindor. And they'll turn an inning-ending double play. Sensational play by Lindor. Just to grab that ball, let alone whirl around.
Everybody on their feet. Green sets, fires. A swing and a drive to deep right, away back, off the pole. A grand slam, high off the right field foul pole. He's done it again, Francisco Lindor.
How do I? It's so hard to say goodbye to yesterday.
Well, with that hammy slash sad song to open the show, it is time for another episode of A Swing and a Try podcast, part of the Press Play Podcast Network. I'm your host, Mike Voorhees, and alongside me, as always, I'm going to somberly send it to you there, B-Spills. We have to do this.
No, I can't do this episode right now. Sorry, it's been a while since we had one, and now we have to do this again. Our last episode was emotional because Indians lost. We were so upset. And now this, Michael.
Yeah.
Mikey V. What? I don't know. Like I said, hopefully we'll get to an episode here shortly in the near future
that doesn't involve emotions.
Yeah, and like, let's just talk baseball and not like negativity, and we want to hit 2021 off right, you know, considering everything going on. But here we are. It's a sad day, you know, if Francisco Lindor and Carlos Carrasco were traded to the New York Mets on Thursday, February, jumping ahead already,
yeah.
January 7th.
Thanks for trying to fast forward.
I know, I want to. I'm trying to get through this. I just want to be done with it. But so let's just, there's no easy way to get into this, Mike.
Just rip the Band-Aid off.
Just rip it off. I want to hear your initial thoughts about this, and then I'll give you mine a little bit.
Well, so let's start at the beginning. If you were living under a rock or you haven't heard, like Brent said, the Cleveland Indians traded shortstop Francisco Lindor and starting pitcher Carlos Cookie Carrasco to the New York Mets. In exchange, the Indians will receive infielder Ahmed Rosario, infielder Andreas Jimenez, starting pitcher Ryan Wolf, and outfielder Isaiah Green. Any of those names jump off the page?
Not really.
Okay.
So that's who we traded for. Now tell me, they let the emotions out, Mike. I want to know, how do you feel about this? Go.
All right. So when I got the text message from a friend of ours that the Indians and Mets were deep in talks, we knew this day was coming, folks. We knew that Lindor was going to get dealt, but it still hurts. Like, Lindor gone, like that was weird. And then to add the salary dump / gut punch of trading Cookie Carrasco, who the entire city rallied around in 2019 with his whole battle with leukemia and the All-Star game. Do you remember that? Like, that was fantastic. And you traded him too. And I don't know if it was just I expected more of a return for Lindor since he's the number one shortstop in the league. Go ahead and try to debate me on this and I will destroy you. He's the number one shortstop in the league. Go ahead.
Sorry, too soon.
He and Cookie, like, we know what he meant to this team, and I'm not happy with the return, Brent. I mean, I knew we were going to trade Lindor, but in my mind, I guess I expected some more oomph in the trade, I guess.
Yeah. I know we've talked a lot about this, and we always say, oh, this is time for another day. We'll talk about this another day. Today is that other day.
Yeah.
Today is the day that we actually have to go into this a little more.
So you asked me, Brent. Let me ask you. How do you feel about this trade?
Dude, this is weird because the whole time, you know, I'm leading up, you know it's coming. And I'm like, okay, I'm okay with it. Like, unfortunately, for the last, what, a few years, I feel like after the World Series, when the Indians offered him, you know, $100 million contract and it was turned down, right then we knew, okay, this is going to be tough. Yeah. This is the, like, this is where we're headed. I'm like trying to prepare myself. But no matter how much you want to try to prepare yourself for pain or something negative, you never can fully.
Oh.
And it hits. And then it hits me yesterday. I'm like, oh, this actually happened. This, oh, now it's here. Now he's gone. That smile is gone. That beautiful hair is gone. And I love when he dyes it.
Yeah.
I think it's cool.
Mr. Smile.
Yeah, I do. It's just, it's, oh, the face of baseball, you know? And now it, like, I don't know. I'm taken back a little bit. I'm like, oh, man, was there a way we could have kept him? I mean, is there a way? I don't know. And then that's my emotional. That's like the emotional part of it. That's my heart, you know?
Right.
But then my head is like, we knew this was coming. This happens with every single superstar that, you know, is brought up through our system in this organization. They're usually always traded or they walk in free agency. That's just how it is. And it stings, man. It absolutely stings. I'm not disappointed in, like, the trade, like I said, because we know it was coming. But how you mentioned about Cookie, though, that one bothers me a little bit. Like, just kind of throwing Cookie in there. At least I feel they threw him in there for a salary dump.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Just to kind of take more money off the books and what he's meant for the community and this team and, like, how he's been here for so long. And that stings right there, too, along with Frankie. But, like I said, we knew it was coming. I'm not upset about the trade, but emotionally right now, it's hard.
Yeah.
It's hard to be like, oh, your franchise is just gone. Like your franchise player.
Yeah.
I mean, we still got a couple players left that are pretty dominant, but
if you had gone to Progressive Field to watch a game, obviously prior to COVID and that, how many Lindor jerseys would you have seen in that stadium? A ton. Like he, like you said, was the face of our franchise, and just like that, he's gone.
Gone, it's here. Like, yeah, he's gone.
Yeah.
You know, like we were upset when like Yan Gomes was gone.
Yeah.
And, like, other guys were gone.
Cargo
is gone, man. You were crying for days in that one.
I was.
Oh, man.
I might be crying for, like, the entire year for
I know.
Winter, man,
and then COVID hits, and then, like, that's what stinks, man. Like, this, especially in this offseason, it's such a tough market. So we knew we weren't going to get tons in return, but we had to trade them.
The fans didn't even get to give them a proper, like, goodbye. No fans last year. Nobody watched him. Except
know,
on the TV.
Right.
And
yeah.
Maybe those that were able to sneak down to West, whatever the street that is, where you can stand there and, like, look in the fence and you can see the games going on. They didn't even get
to
give
him. Corner of Ontario and Carnegie.
Couldn't even say goodbye to him. So you know the fans are frustrated and upset.
It
is. You've seen Twitter. You've seen sports talk shows. Like, this is huge.
And we've talked about this a lot of, like, can we keep him? Can the Dolans keep him? Can they afford him? Yes, they can. No, they can't. It's a small market. It's the baseball's fault. It's the Dolans' fault. It's Cleveland's
COVID's fault,
COVID's fault. Like, it's like, I think it's all of the above.
Yeah.
Like, and we've talked about the Dolans. Remember when he did that interview? I think it was like March of 2019.
Just enjoying.
Yeah. And so ever since then, we're like, he's gone. So 2019 season, 2020 season, I can never fully embrace Frankie. And I feel bad about that because we knew he was gone.
Yeah.
And then he was talking at like Tribe Fest last year. It was like in February before spring training. The reporters were drilling him, you know, about all this stuff and money. And you just knew then, you know. And then actually I just saw something. I don't know if it was it John Heyman on Twitter?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not. Yeah. Yeah. I think he mentioned something like the Indians did talk to him and his team agent about extending a contract around like $200 million. That's the first time I heard an actual number of what the Indians offered. So I'm like, man, that's the most money the Indians have ever offered anybody.
I'll take $200 million.
So I'm not like, yeah, no kidding. So I'm like, add that in the stimulus.
Yeah.
But I'm just kidding.
But, too soon.
Yeah, yeah. But, oh, man, it's just so odd.
Yeah, it is. So let's dive into some of these players so that maybe we can kind of get an idea of what we're getting in return. And I'm going to start with the prospects. So Isaiah Green is an outfielder. He's 19 years old. He was ranked the 10th best Mets prospect. However, he's only played in 5 professional games so far. He's projected to make his major league debut in 2024. So 3 years, figure he'll develop in the minors. Ryan Wolf, starting pitcher. He's 20 years old. He was ranked the Mets' ninth best prospect. Projected to make his debut in the majors in 2023. He has an upper 90s fastball and a 12-6 curveball. So if you don't know what a 12-6 curveball is, it's like a hands on the clock. That's the drop from 12 to 6, and people are talking about it, that it's pretty good. He made 5 starts in the 2019 Gulf Coast League with the Mets, had a 3.38 earned run average, and he struck out 36.4% of the 33 batters faced. So that kind of gets me excited. You know how we are with pitching here in Cleveland. We seem to regenerate pitching extremely well. You move on to Andreas Giménez. He's an infielder, 22 years old. He made his major league debut this past year in 2020. Hit .263, 3 home runs, 12 RBIs, but that was only in 39 games. He's got above average defense. He was ranked in the top one or two of the Mets prospects prior to going to the majors. He is ranked as the 84th best prospect according to MLB Pipeline. And I have a feeling he's going to be our starting second baseman since Cesar Hernandez left by way of free agency. And then moving on to, I think, the big piece of the trade, Ahmed Rosario, 25 years old. He's been in the league 4 years, career .268 hitter. He's going to be our leadoff guy and obviously our starting shortstop. Hits left-handed pitching really well, career .300 average against lefties. He can play second and third. So we finally get a leadoff hitter, which is good. He's kind of average on defense. I don't think he's as good as Frankie is, but we get a leadoff hitter that can hit. He hits lefties well. Now we have to play the wait-and-see game.
Prospects. That's a word we've heard a lot over the years. Every time we trade somebody is the word prospects. But the thing is, like, we never knew who they were. How many times have we made trades that we're like, yeah, I don't know who that. The player to be named later. Like, who are these guys coming in? And they all turn out, a lot of them turn out pretty well.
Michael Brantley was a player to be named later in the CC Sabathia
trade. Let me go through some of these.
Yeah, please do.
Because we know, we'll get into the Dolans, I think, here in a minute again. But Chris Antonetti and Mike Chernoff, the president and the GM of the Indians, they do what they can do. I mean, they are top-notch. I mean, they can't control the money stuff. You know what I mean?
Nope.
But they do a phenomenal job. And we know, like you mentioned earlier, what the pitching staff does and organization developing talent. Now, if we could develop outfielders, that would be great. But our pitching development is usually.
Do I sense a little bitterness since Tyler Naquin's not here anymore?
Oh, I forgot about that. I almost forgot about that because of all this.
Oh, man. Sorry.
Goodness gracious.
I just ripped the other Band-Aid off. My apologies.
Did he sign anywhere yet?
No, he's still a free agent.
Maybe he'll come back.
He could.
Man, I liked him. Anyways, I got to keep moving on here. So this was actually a tweet from Jensen Lewis. If you guys know who he is, he's on Sports Time Ohio, pregame, postgame. He used to play for the Indians. He was a bullpen guy. He just kind of listed some of these trades from the past. So it was kind of interesting. He talked about when he was on the team and we traded CeCe and Casey Blake in 2008. We got Carlos Santana and Michael Brantley, like you said, the player to be named later. 2009. We sent another Cy Young winner, Cliff Lee, away, and we got Carlos Carrasco. We traded Victor Martinez and Jake Westbrook in 2010, and we got Justin Masterson and Corey Kluber. 2012, we traded Shin Soo Chu and Esmil Rogers. We got Trevor Bauer, Brian Shaw, Yan Gomes, and Mike Aviles. Handsome Mike.
Mm-hmm.
I always liked him. In 2014, Vinny Pastano. We traded him to the Angels for Mike Clevenger. Then we end up signing Andrew Miller, Coco Crisp, 2016, Edwin, 2017, and then traded for Jay Bruce in 2017. We traded for Brad Hand in 2018. And then 2019, we traded Bauer for Franmil Reyes, Yasiel Puig, and Logan Allen. With the jury still out on Franmil and Logan Allen, but we'll see. There's, once again, the prospects word. So that's just kind of a handful there of examples of how the guys we didn't know coming in all. The majority of them played pretty well. So we have to trust this front office. I know this is disappointing to get rid of Frankie, but we knew it was coming. Regardless if it's the Dolans, if it's the small market, if whatever it is, if it's a baseball issue, like, we just can't afford that much money for Frankie, it would just paralyze the team. We won't be able to build at all around him. Mm-mm. But the thing that gets me is, like, just a few years ago, we were like, what, $130, $140 million payroll? And it's projected we're going to be at around 35 or 40 for 2021.
Yeah, I know people have been looking at online, and there's some stuff floating around that the Indians' payroll currently is $22.9 million. But let's look at the facts that that's without arbitration, and the league minimum has not been set for the upcoming year. So that number will go up a little bit. But, yeah, like you said, Brent, it's going to be between 30 and 40 million, which will put them dead last in the majors. The team that is the second worst is the Pittsburgh Pirates at 47 million, and we know how bad they were last year.
I mean, I'm not worried about being that bad because, like, the Rays have done it. You know what
I
mean?
Absolutely.
Like, it's hard. We'll have to get into another episode of, like, what we think for the upcoming season. But right mm-hmm. now, we just can't do that tonight. But we're only going to have, I think, projected five players. I mean, they still make some signings, small signings. But as of right now, on the team, we have five players that are going to earn more than the league minimum. So we got Jose Ramirez, about $9.4 million. Roberto Perez, $5.5 million. Austin Hedges, who we got in trade last year, $3 million, probably in arbitration. Nick Wickren, $2 million. And Phil Maton, was it Maton? Maton, I never know.
Phil Maton.
Maton, I don't want to say his name wrong. He might expect it to make about $850,000. Those are the top five guys right now.
And I think Wickren's actually 2.2.
Okay. So still, I mean.
Yeah. Only great.
Fantastic. Oh, man. It just.
I just have one question. Why do we need two catchers making $8.5 million? I know both of them are really good defensively. I have a feeling one of them's
because Hedges is going to ball out this year.
I hope so.
Berto's going to come back. They're both going to bring it.
No, that's fine.
No, I don't know. That's
we need somebody to play first.
That's a good question. Yeah, I have no idea.
No,
I mean,
that's for another episode.
And think about this: if we have a $35 million payroll or 35 to 40, here's some players that make that by themselves. Nolan, I can always say his last name wrong. Cut Rockies guy.
Arenado.
I always butcher it. Steven Strasburg,
yep.
Zach Greinke,
mm-hmm.
Max Scherzer, Garrett Cole, and, of course, the Mike Trout.
Yeah. Probably the greatest player in the major leagues, and he's making.
But the Angels are terrible.
Yeah. They're slowly getting better.
You know, Colorado's never good. I mean, they start out hot, and then they usually kind of sizzle.
They're trying to trade Arenado.
I like him.
His name's been thrown around all winter long about trades.
I mean, I like the Rockies, but I feel bad for them, too.
Notice that most of those are pitchers.
Yeah. I mean,
Bieber's name's going to be on that list eventually.
Yeah, on another team.
Oh,
we're not
going to
start that. Sorry. It's the emotions. It's not me. Don't hold me accountable for this.
I can't take three losses in one episode. I can't. Two's hard enough.
We're not going to talk about any other players leaving the team right now, okay? So, Mike, I'm telling you that.
Okay.
All right. I don't want Brody too upset.
I have a question for you.
Yeah.
Do you still have faith in this team?
I do.
Do you think we're going to compete?
Define compete.
Do you think we're not going to be dead last or third, fourth, or fifth in the division? So we can either be one or two. Do you think we'll be there?
I don't know. I still
don't
can't
answer that.
We have to wait to see. But
let's see what other moves they make. I'm going to tell you right now, I think they're going to be third or fourth.
One word.
What's that?
Tito.
Got to believe.
Every time
Hold on, I got another word for you.
Okay.
Bieber. AL Cy Young Award winner, man.
He's back. Another word. Hosey.
J-Ram. Absolutely. I mean, we have some players.
We do.
Let's rally around them. Let's enjoy them now because we don't know what
the future
holds.
Okay, you just had to. You even mean to say enjoy them now? You didn't even mean to, did you?
I didn't. I've got Dolan.
You did not even mean to do
right
that.
Now.
You just said enjoy them now.
But what I'm saying, let's let's see what we have. Let's look at what's in front of us. And let's enjoy Indians baseball right now, okay? Let's not worry about free agency, trades, any of that stuff. Because guess what? Cleveland, we still have a baseball team. We don't know what their name will be eventually. Right now, they're still the Indians. It's still our tribe. It's still our podcast, and we're going to cover the Indians. We're going to cover the good, the bad, and the ugly like we've always done. And go forward, man. That's all we can do.
Want to know something funny?
What's that?
I saw this on Twitter by Ryan and Niles.
Yeah.
He said Bobby Bonilla will receive a larger paycheck this year than the majority of players on Cleveland's opening day roster.
Thank you, New York Mets. That Bobby is Bonilla hilarious. Day. If you're not, if you don't know what that is, Bobby Bonilla signed this monstrosity of a contract before he retired, and it pays him on a certain day every year, and he gets like $2 million or something on that day every year. And Bobby Bonilla is like mid-40s, probably 50 now, and still getting paid.
That was a good tweet.
Nice contract.
Oh, but man. Okay. Mike, how are you feeling about the Dolans right now? I don't want to spend too much time, and we're going to have to.
Here's my thing.
But
I trust Tito. I trust Chernoff, and I trust Antonetti. I do. Those three guys can only do what they can control, and that's what they're given. Now, Mr. Dolan, I understand that you want to cut money, and you COVID was hard, and I get it, okay? But in our eyes, with being a small market team, we need to spend money in order to compete with the Padres, the Yankees, the Dodgers, the Cubs, these big market teams that have money. Can you please find money in your checkbook, sign Bieber long-term, do something to make the fans happy? Because right now, we want your head on a platter. Because we couldn't get Lindor to stay. We traded Cookie, who was an inspiration to millions of people. I don't like Mr. Dolan right now. I don't. I don't like the Dolans. I don't want to be Moneyball. I understand that it works for some teams, and I've seen the movie, and I know Tampa Bay's been able to do it, but even they can't keep people, and they trade people. Just give us a World Series, put a competitive team on the field that will win games. That's all I want.
They have. I'm going to say
2021. I want to see this team be competitive.
Well, they've been competitive for years.
They have been, but we haven't been able to get over the hump.
They were right there. They were game 7. I mean,
2016.
I'm always riding the line on this. I've said that before in previous episodes that I'm not probably against the Dolans as much as you are.
I know I was sleeping in game 7.
But right now I'm starting to get a little upset. It's starting to get me a little bit. You know, I'm seeing this and this trade and throwing Cookie in there, and the money's just dropping. I'm like, man. But it's tough because, like, COVID obviously affected things. There was no fans in the stadium, but we hardly have fans go. It is highly watched, though. We do know that. So people are still watching. But are fans going to, like, leave again? Are they going to come? I don't know what's going to happen. Like, this is going to hit hard, man. Like, not spending anything, being the lowest in the
I saw a lot of posts on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram of people just saying they're done with the Indians and they're done. They're frustrated. And I'm that way too. Like, I'm not going to give up on this team just because I'm a diehard baseball fan. Always have been. Always will be. I am frustrated with the Dolans, and I see both sides of the coin. If this team wins a World Series in 2021, are we even going to have this discussion? All that matters is they're competitive and they win games, and once the playoffs come, they don't fold. We don't have an issue. You just win. That's it. I think that's all this city wants, is we want to see a competitive winner, but we also don't want to lose players that we get behind and we invest in and we support. I'm tired of seeing guys walk out the door. Tommy, Bell, Ramirez, Brantley, Sabathia, Lee.
Yeah, I mean,
Lindor. Like,
but that's always going to happen. That will happen in Cleveland.
I don't want.
And the thing
to.
Is, you said talk about being competitive. We've been in the playoffs, but think about this too. We've had Frankie. We've had these guys since we were up 3-1 on the Cubs. Mm-hmm. We've won what, 2 playoff games?
Yeah,
that's it.
Yeah.
So I'm like, they're putting them in position, but the players either aren't executing, and last year was hard with COVID and Tito getting sick. You know what I mean? And they blew that second game against the Yankees in the playoffs.
But wait a minute. Lindor, if you heard in the clip earlier, the Grand Slam, that was in the playoffs against the Yankees. I was getting ready to say
that was 2017.
Lindor hasn't done squat in the playoffs is what I was getting ready to say. And I'm like, well, wait a minute. He's had some moments, but not last year. In 2020, we lose to the Yankees. 2019.
Well, that's what I'm saying, though. Why are you so upset that we're letting him walk then?
I have invested time, and I think he's an incredible talent.
Yeah.
He came up with the Indians. I followed his career. I've watched him in Akron. I've watched him in Columbus, or not in Columbus, but wherever it was in 2015.
Yeah.
I remember going to Chicago to watch the Cubs-Indians game to watch his debut. It got rained out, and I was pretty bummed, but I knew that this kid was something special, and then we've watched him since 2015. I didn't want to see him leave.
I know. I mean, anytime you have a homegrown player and they develop into, like, superstar status, and they're so good for you, and plus he's so awesome off the field, and just, you know, his energy, like, the way he loves baseball, the way he even, like, you know, loved the city of Cleveland and never was in trouble. You know, like, he's right. Such an awesome guy. So that's the part that really hurts, too. And like just, I said, you hate to see these guys go, but it does happen. We're still going to support this team no matter what. And let's just hope that a lot of these young guys, like, look at Bieber now. And I mean, they're coming up. We got homecomers.
Plesac, Savali, Quantrill, who we picked up last year and really didn't get to see a lot of. Karinchak in the bullpen. We got pitching.
I mean, all, yeah. And all these new guys. We got prospects. We got them. Frannimal. Yeah, we'll see what happens. I mean, I'm excited to see what happens. At least now, like, I feel relieved in a sense that, like, it's done.
We talked about it.
Like,
it's, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, like, he's gone. Like, I don't like it, but I understand it, and I have to accept it. But now we can move on because, like, I feel like it's just been, like, that monkey on the back for the last 2 years. You know what I mean?
It's been hanging over our heads, man.
Yeah, 2 years plus. But
guess what? It's 2021.
Yeah.
It's a new year. We're going to have big things with our network and with the podcast. I mean, I don't want to let too many secrets out of the bag, but we got some things coming, guys. It's
yeah,
okay.
It's going to be a fun year. You know, once the season gets around here, hopefully we have an actual 162-game season.
I think we will.
So
they just haven't set a start date.
Yeah, so we'll see how that works. But we're excited about that. Like you said, we're excited about the network. We're excited about the pod. And everything. We appreciate everybody listening. We're sorry this is too emotional podcasts or episodes back to back, but you know, you're probably feeling the same thing. Like mm-hmm. we say, we are fans at heart, 100%. And this hurts.
It does.
Even if I have to, you know, I understand, like I said, I accepted it. It still hurts, but we're fans and we're going to move through this together. We got this. Right, Mike?
Absolutely, bro. It's tribe time, baby. Let's go.
It is.
Regardless of what the name's going to be, regardless of who they put on the field, we're going to talk about it. We're going to support them. And maybe, just maybe, in 2021, we're hoisting a World Series trophy. Can't say it's not possible.
There you go.
Anything's possible.
Your predictions are the best. I tell you what, the Mikey V predictions are the best around. The most positive outlook we have here. But, no, seriously, thank you for tuning in. This is such a sad pod. We knew it was coming, but it still stings, like we've said. And hopefully the next one will be more about gearing up for the season. Not sure when the next one's going to drop, but just stay tuned. We'll let you know. And, yeah, anything else, Mike?
Nope. Follow us on Facebook and Twitter. A Swingin' a Tribe MLB podcast on Facebook. And on Twitter, we are at A Swingin' a Tribe. And I'm looking forward to a great 2021 with you, B-Spills.
Awesome, man. Me as well, dude. Have a good night, everybody.
Who keeps you cheering year after year? Who's got the ballpark? The best is all right here. Who's got the fans? So much Cleveland pride. Who's talking baseball?